without further ado, please allow me to introduce our panelists. For our first presentation, we have Professor Emily Francomano, Associate Professor in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese at Georgetown University. Her scholarly interests revolve around the intersections of medieval and early modern literature, translation, gender studies, manuscript culture, and book history. Her most recent book, Free Spanish Querel Texts, is a study, translation, and bilingual edition of key works from the medieval Iberian debate on women. Situated in Grisel y Mirabella, the Maldecir de Mujeres, and the Defensa de las Donas in intertextual dialogue, Free Spanish Querel Texts also studies their historical context and international afterlives. It's an honor for us to have Dr. Francomano offer us this morning Translata Proficit, Translation and Translatio in the Libro de Buen Amor. Dr. Francomano.
Thank you. The title of my paper is an anachronistic appropriation from John Florio's prologue to his English translation of Montaigne's essays, titled To the Courteous Reader. And I'll just mention that all of the quotes in the PowerPoint are the same as the ones on the handout. I was worried there might not be enough on the handout, and the order has changed slightly. So his prologue is titled To the Courteous Reader. It's an encomium and defense of translation, in which Florio takes the Latin proverb translata proficit arbos, a tree grows well when transplanted, in quote one, and as he says, wittingly mistakes it. Conveying only translata proficit, what is translated advances, makes progress for his beneficial. Florio's willful misappropriation and loss of Latin wisdom, composed in order to applaud and move forward with his own translation, though far removed in time and space from the Libro de Buen Amor, recalls to my mind at least the disputación que los griegos y los romanos en uno vieron. The example of, like Florio's prologue, is a justification of translation, a celebration and a send-up of the benefits of translation designed to prime the archpriest's audiences to move forward through the Libro. My aim in this paper is to reread the disputación in light of translation theory and history in order to reflect upon the archpriest's and the Libro's engagements with the tradition of the MESTER de CLERECÍA and its projects of translatio. And this is very much a work in progress, as with all things having to do with the arcipreste, and his book, The Way That Thou Shalt Go, is long, and his accompanying bibliography, as Marianne can tell us, is rich and long, and it's with some trepidation that I sit before you to give this work in progress of many people here whose work has so profoundly influenced my own, so many, so long. So anyway, Copla 46, Entiende bien mis dichos y piensa la sentencia. There's perhaps no other moment in the Libro de Buen Amor that captures quite as well how the book and its notoriously fragmentary author figure and the arcipreste set themselves up as parodies of translatio studii than this episode. Significantly, the archpriest frames his burlesque in quaderna via, a metrical form that, as we all know, signals the transmission of authority into the vernacular, performed and mediated by a clerkly linguistic middleman. Scholarship on the Greeks and the Romans has focused above all on its importance to one of the Libro's central obsessions, the ambiguity of signs. As Lawrence Deluce, for example, sums up the moral of the episode, the potentiality that perfect understanding and complete misunderstanding might be interchangeable and undiscoverable threatens to destabilize the whole process of meaning. The very rightness of an interpretation might therefore indicate nothing more than its massive wrongness. This agreement based on communication and error, as Barletta observes in his study of pragmatics in the Anselmum, is an example of how, to quote Barletta, the Libro transports Augustinian sign theory deeper into the post-lapsarian linguistic agora than the church father would ever have let to go. Now, to speak of translation is necessarily to speak of sign theory and the relationships between res and verba. Following directly upon a translation in gloss of Plato's couplet, there, with pleasure lighten now, and then thy care, so life's burdens thou mayest better bear, the introduction to the Greeks and the Romans directly echoes the archpriest's instructions to look beyond el son feo de las palabras, and to find meaning and intentions that he issues in the prose prologue, and his concatenation of metaphors in verse, 10 in total, for the relationship between signifiers and signified. For example, sola spina sala. Sola spina sta la rosa noble flor, so fea letra sta saber de gran doctor, so mala capa yace buen bebedor, and si sol mal albardo está el buen amor. It is also, I would argue, necessary to speak of translation when we consider the cleric's craft, translatio studii, and translatio imperii as well. Even though neither Juan Ruiz, Berceo, nor any of the anonymous authors of the Apollonio or Alexandre were composing direct or what we might call faithful translation. Translatio is, as Gumbrecht puts it, the keeping alive of the knowledge of the past in the service of the present. And as Olivier Piacini remarked just yesterday, it is a decontextualization and actualization of sources. And elsewhere, Piacini cautions us that to separate our ideas of translation and translatio, noting that while the former means just linguistic transfer, the second, while still meaning to carry over, also incorporates the concept of metaphorical transformation and the actions of glossing, expounding, and teaching. This separation of translatio from translation, narrowly understood, is of course essential for understanding how the MESTER poets romanced tradition. In this paper, however, I am rejoining translatio and translation because not only is linguistic transfer a precondition for translatio studii and translatio imperii, but Juan Ruiz's adaptation of this tale, The Tale of the Debate in Signs, is a story about the processes and achievement of such translatio. The transfer of knowledge and power depends on the translation of tongues, or, as the disputación would have it, upon the mistranslation of hands. The disputación reenacts debates about some of the most hotly debated questions in translation history, namely the respective values of sense for sense versus word for word translation, the existence or impossibility of linguistic equivalence, which makes so-called faithful translation imaginable, and the violence and necessary betrayals of translation. And quote 6 and 7 on the handout gives some classic statements. And here are some classic statements. A further question of great interest to contemporary translation theories, and I think also to us in our appreciation of the MESTER poets, concerns the status of translators as authors. The dream of equivalent, pure, and reversible translation begins with the story of Babel and the fall of language, which created the rift between res and verba, and the consequent need for interpretation. It is also exemplified in the legend of the Septuagint and its vision of redeemed language, where res once again magically reunites with verba in the translation of scripture, translatable thus in multiple human languages in what Eugene Nida would later call dynamic equivalence. The concepts of violence and loss in translation stand in opposition to the virtues and purities of equivalence. Target and source languages and cultures always exist in relationships of unequal power and cultural capital. Translation zones are often war zones, as Emily Apter knows, and translation history is in many ways a history of colonizing, appropriations, and theft of translatio imperii. Moreover, translations inflict harm and mutilate their sources, as Lawrence Venuti has argued, by removing original texts from their context and domesticating them. When the past is translated into the present, anachronism becomes a form of domestication. When the Romans appeal to the Greeks to pass down their wisdom, they are seeking vertical translation, that is, the translation of a superior culture down to a receiving audience in need of cultivation and into a language of lesser refinement. However, vertical translation is stimulated by the rising hegemony of the receiving culture in need of legitimization through its appropriation of autoritas. And this double verticality, where authority is vested in the past, but power, appropriation, and the need for legitimate target cultures present, is clear, this double verticality is clearly present in the MESTER. The Greeks doubt that the Romans deserve to be their intellectual heirs and decide to test the younger, less advanced to hold the debate in sign language. And there's no explanation of how they come to this agreement. There must have been a translator off in the wings ready to broker the deal. The Greeks elect their wisest sage, we all know this. And the Romans, recalling a commonplace metaphor for translation itself, dress a rogue up as a professor of philosophy to debate. The form of quadernavia and the sequence of signs set up a pattern of equivalence. Repetitions of levantose, asentose, y mostro underline the exact sign for sign exchange between the doctor and the bellaco, quote 8 on the handout, as do the translations of signs into words that each reports to his respective language group. In their performance, it appears that word for word, faithful translations occur, and since they are dealing not just with words, but the word, word for word, is supposedly sense for sense. The Greeks conclude that the Romans do indeed have the mental capacities necessary to merit the transmission of wisdom after the sage translates, domesticating the Roman signs for his compatriots when he renders them as comprehensible of affirmations of the Trinity, quote 9. The Roman, on the other hand, translated the Greek signs as threats of physical violence that required responses in kind. The Romano's domesticating translation, quote 10, reveals the violence of cultural transfer. Translating in the contact zone becomes a contact sport. Nevertheless, both linguistic middlemen presume that they are faithful translators who have met on the solid ground of shared meaning. Not only do they have faith in their own abilities of understanding, they have faith in the equivalence, reversibility, and in the transparency of signs. This is a scene where translatio turns into translation, where the fidus interpretis translates word for word, but creates his own sense of the signs. A strange twist on Jerome's dictum that we must translate non verbum e verbo sed sensum de sensu, not word for word, but sense for sense, except, of course, in the case of Holy Scripture, where even the syntax contains a mystery. That was quote 6. Although the disputation is staged as a test, a precondition for the definitive translatio studii, the Greek begins his transfer of the law and the word in the signed conversation, as un dios, uno en tres personas, etc., etc. For the purposes of translatio, the Greek, in parodic imitation of the incarnation, translates the word into the flesh, turning his body into the material sign that cloaks his transcendence. The Roman is incapable of reversing the process and reads the Greek's letters as flesh rather than spirit. Of course, there's some irony in the depiction of the Greeks as Christians, able to interpret ambiguous signs according to the Augustinian rule of charity, the general principle being that no interpretation can be true which does not promote the love of God and the love of man, from De Doctrina Christiana Book 3. As Denis points out in his reading of the tale, in its multiple medieval and folkloric versions, the story Christianizes Roman and Greek law in the typological fashion that Christianity considers the Jews to be the first custodians of the law, and the Christians those who know how to understand it correctly. The Christianization of the Greek law, which in turn became the Roman law, was not understood by the Romans, who would, in due course, pass it along to the Christian monarchies of Europe, who, with the true knowledge of Revelation, could indeed understand it as the law backed by theology. Our clerkly poets and their audiences stand at the end of this chain of translatio. When the word becomes flesh, it is translated back into the word by the Greeks, but into more flesh by the Romans, the disputation stages linguistic mediation, making acts of translation and interpretation visible and palpable. The exemplum is introduced by the archpriest warning about the Roman road, one of the many appropriative domesticated translations in the sprawling series of fables, fabliau, allegories, comedies, and songs that make up the libro. It also tells a story of how translation can fail spectacularly while still achieving the translatio studii upon which the authority of Christian Latinity is based. Indeed, then, translation is perilous yet crucial in this pivotal exemplum, which kicks off the libro de buen humor and which ends with the transfer of Greece's cultural pattern into the hands of the uncouth Romans, who believe they have wrested wisdom from their antagonists by threatening physical harm. Translations like typology and allegory are the sine qua non of translatio, but they are untrustworthy. The many parallelisms suggesting equivalence and structureless exchange of misinterpreted signs ironically underscore the violence and the simultaneously disguised and highly visible nature of translation. Paul Ricoeur, in his essays on translation, remarks that equivalence does not make translation possible. Rather, translation itself creates equivalence. The exchange in signs shows one way in which dynamic equivalence can be created from dissimilarity through acts of translation. Thanks to the metaphorical reading of hand signs, followed by the linguistic transfer of sign language into Greek and presumably Latin to Romans, translatio goes forward. Both translations, the Greek theological and the Roman pugilistic, are relevant translations, to borrow Derrida's term, quote, 12. Not only are their translations qualitatively equivalent, they achieve their mission. They are the best and most useful translations for the two target cultures in the two target languages. And the archpriest's romancing of the tale, prefaced by the warning, non me contesta, non contesta contigo, or non me contesta contigo como el doctor de Grecia, reveals yet more layers of linguistic and interpretive mediation and appropriation. As for authorship, in El Tostado's typology of translation, these translators are not interpretes, but glosadores, and our MESTER poets are glosadores, revisionary authors. And Bonaventure's similar 13th century taxonomy of authorship, which includes the scriptor, the compilator, and the commentator, and finally the auctor, implicitly references translation. The auctor, unlike the others who copy, organize, and comment, writes both his own materials and those of others, but presents his own as the principal materials and the materials of others annexed for the purpose of confirming his own, and as such must be called the author. In this taxonomy, our 13th century Mester poets blend the activities of commentador and the autor, and Juan Ruiz, who parodies as he glosses, is, I would argue, a translating autor. Juan Ruiz, the extraordinary translator of tradition, appeals tongue firmly in cheek to the very autores, Cato and the like. He transmits like a Roman rogue, filling the gaps between equivalents with a language that is full of life and perfect in its intentional misinterpretation. The Greeks and the Romans is not only important in Libra's place upon ambiguity, but also for understanding how the archpriest's translatio depends upon the faithless translator, who undermines while he privileges authority. In the process, the archpriest de Libra, clerical autor, and mediator between his audience and authority, becomes the rogue translator. And despite our poet's reverence and tinged with high irony in Juan Ruiz's case for auctoritas, for the 13th and 14th century poets, faithful translation is both anachronistic and free. Translatio is not the translation of the fidus interpretes, but mistranslation, appropriation. Translated things are beneficial to the translators and their audiences, regardless of the faithlessness and violence involved in their transfer. In order to redeem the pre-Christian Greeks and Romans, not to mention Alexander and Polonio, for their present concerns, the poets must translate beyond the letter as linguistic middlemen, or perhaps Professor Lavin would say, as translingual middlemen, on anachronistic and domesticating missions, standing upon the shifting sands between medium and message and medium. They are part Greek sage and part ribald Roman. And Juan Ruiz parodies their positions as he joins their ranks.